Hello, welcome to Craig Explains Stuff. I'm Craig, and today I'm going to be talking about weather modification or weather control. Now, I realize this seems like a topic from some science fiction movie or maybe from a video game, but weather modification is a real thing, and it doesn't require some crazy, mad scientist-looking laboratory. Because actual weather modification in the real world, it mostly takes place through a process known as cloud seeding. And the machinery for it is the small console which is strapped onto the back wing of a plane. Now, some of you may be thinking, hey, is that what I see when I see a plane overhead and a lot of smoke or steam is coming out of the back of it? No, that's usually just exhaust. Cloud seeding looks more like this. It looks more like a firework has been going off, and it's really hard to see from the ground, especially during daylight. Now, for a little bit about the history and development of cloud seeding. Cloud seeding was first thought of by this man, Louis Gathman. Now, Louis Gathman was an inventor who mostly made mill equipment and farm equipment. But in 1891, he wrote a book called Rain Produced at Will. And in this book, he talked about seeding clouds with chemicals. And modern day cloud seeding is actually based on the principles that he wrote about in this book. Now, the research for it was started in earnest in the 1930s, and the first actual field test was done in upstate New York in 1946. And cloud seeding works like this. You disperse chemicals onto or into the clouds. This is usually done with a plane, but can also be done with a rocket from the ground. And these chemicals, when they get into the cloud, they're actually cool. So the water vapor will attach to these chemicals and cool down. And as soon as the water vapor cools down, it turns into liquid H2O, which falls down out of the sky in the form of rain, or often as snow. Now, the chemicals that are used, I know when I say, oh, you're spraying chemicals in the ground, a lot of people are going to get suspicious. So it's three major kind of chemicals that are used, and that's silver iodine, potassium iodine, or dry ice. Silver iodine used to be an antiseptic, but since silver iodine contains silver, it can discolor the skin, and it turns the skin a sort of a bluish gray color. And unfortunately, this is permanent. So once your skin is dyed this bluish gray color from the silver iodine, it stays that color basically forever. So it lost popularity as an antiseptic due to this coloration problem. And silver iodine is mostly only used today for cloud seeding. Potassium iodine is a thyroid medicine. It's also our major medicine used to treat radiation poisoning. So potassium iodine is a very important medicine in addition to being used for cloud seeding. And dry ice is common. You can often buy it at stores locally to you. Dry ice is just a solid form of carbon dioxide. So it is generally considered non-toxic and harmless. Dry ice is actually not really that harmless because it's so cold that you can instantly get frostbite. So you do have to handle it with care, but it's not considered toxic to the environment. So the other two chemicals, silver iodine and potassium iodine, those are officially classified as pollutants. And you might think to yourself, well, dumping pollutants into the cloud to do cloud seeding and weather modification, surely that's bad for the environment. But extensive studies done by California and done by Australia have indicated that there is no noticeable effect of using either of these two chemicals. There's no noticeable change to any groundwater, to soil, to plants, or to animals. They've did extensive studies and were unable to detect any problem at all. However, in the United States, since it's still classified as a pollutant, the EPA, that's the Environmental Protection Agency, carefully regulates cloud seeding using these chemicals under the Clean Water Act. Now, the next question is, why modify the weather? Why do weather control? And as I pointed out, it forms rain. Weather control and weather modification is mostly limited to rainmaking. So the obvious answer is drought. Use it to treat drought. This has actually been used to treat drought for a very long time. This isn't anything new. It's used in America, Canada, Russia, China, India, and it's not just the larger, wealthier countries. Colombia used it to treat drought from 1962 to 1964, which gave them time to build dams to help alleviate their drought problem they had. Thailand has been using cloud seeding since 1969 and have used it pretty regularly every year to help fight drought. Kuwait recently started using it in 2016. Kuwait is having quite a big population explosion, so they're trying to mitigate the spread of the desert by doing cloud seeding to make sure that everything stays enough water to support their larger population. Unfortunately, it's not as good with drought as one would expect. The studies have estimated that it only increases rainfall by about 20 to 30%. Now, this is a significant extra amount of rainfall, but it won't help with severe drought. And another problem with severe drought is illustrated in this photo. This is a photo from Texas when they were having a very severe drought in 2011. And if you notice in the sky, there are no clouds. So there's no clouds to seed in severe drought. Weather modification does require that there is some water vapor already in the air in order for the clouds to be seeded. Otherwise, you're just spraying chemicals all over the sky and they fall to the ground and there's no rain at all. So they're in severe droughts, it can't even be used. Another use for weather modification is to help reduce the effects of hurricanes. Hurricanes are very large. This is a very large hurricane in this photo. And hurricanes do a lot of damage. So any attempt to decrease the power of a hurricane is welcome. So the United States actually started a project called Project Storm Fury. This is a picture of the crew of Project Storm Fury in 1962. And Project Storm Fury was meant to address this problem and try to use cloud seeding to affect hurricanes. Now, in the 60s, when they first started, they actually reported a great deal of success because these planes, in addition to being able to seed the clouds, also had a lot of equipment to monitor the hurricane and to be able to tell what's going on inside of a hurricane. So they seeded these hurricanes and they noticed changes in the storm wall near the eye of the hurricane. So they declared the project a success. Later, however, they continued to send planes into hurricanes without doing any seeding. And it was discovered that all the changes that they had recorded during seeding a hurricane also occurred naturally without seeding the hurricane. So Project Storm Fury was declared a failure and was canceled in the early 1980s. Now, it's a little unfair to call it a failure because they did collect a lot of weather data about hurricanes, and a lot of what we know about hurricanes now was based on the data that Project Storm Fury gathered. So I think it's a little harsh to say that it was a failure, but the military said, well, you didn't meet the objectives, so you failed, and they canceled the project. So a third use of weather modification, and this is the one that conspiracy theorists worry about, and that's not just weather modification, but weather warfare. And we actually have seen in the world weather warfare happen when the United States used it against Vietnam. Now, this is a thing that they called Operation Popeye, and it was executed by the 54th Weather Recon Squadron. And this is the badge for the 54th Weather Recon Squadron during Vietnam. And they started Operation Popeye, and the goal of Operation Popeye was to increase the length of their monsoon season in Vietnam, especially over the area of the Ho Chi Minh Trail. For those of you who don't know your history of the Vietnam War, the Ho Chi Minh Trail was a trail the North Vietnamese used in order to infiltrate South Vietnam. And so by extending the monsoon season, it made this trail a lot muddier. In fact, their slogan was, "Make mud, not war." So this lasted from 1967 to 1972. And it was an extremely top secret project. It was so top secret that a great deal of the leadership of the U.S. military was not informed of it. It was not explained to Congress that we were doing this. Many of the people in the 54th Weather Recon Squadron were unaware of exactly what it was that they were doing. Unfortunately for the squad's commanders who were trying to keep this secret, it did leak out to the press and eventually was published on the front page of the New York Times. And when that happened, the American public was actually made quite angry because in the early 70s, there was a very strong environmental movement within the United States, and they were furious that we were modifying the weather in order to affect another country during wartime. Also, Congress was not particularly happy about such an operation happening for such a long period of time without being informed. And so this sparked a great deal of Senate hearings. And the Senate hearings were, this is how we actually know about the Operation Popeye today, because the Senate hearings were all made public. And they go into a great deal of detail. The Senate was angry about it, and the American people were angry about it. So shortly after all these Senate hearings wrapped up, the U.S. Congress passed a law prohibiting weather modification and warfare. Not only that, but just a little bit later, they brought it before the UN, and they created the Environmental Modification Convention. And this was a treaty saying countries could not use weather modification and warfare, this banned it. All of the green countries on this map became a party to the treaty. They signed it, they ratified it, and they all agreed to ban weather modification in wartime. The countries that are yellow in the map signed the agreement, but for whatever reason, it was never ratified. So they did not actually officially join, although they do have a signature saying that they do agree not to. They're not actually a party to the treaty. The countries in red did not agree, so they're not part of the treaty. But if you notice, some of the most powerful countries, militarily powerful countries, have agreed to not use weather modification and warfare. So by now you might be wondering, okay, it's been banned for use in warfare. It did not have any effect on hurricanes. It has a minimal effect on drought. So what good is weather modification? And that answer is hailstorms. Hailstorms do a great deal of damage worldwide. This is hail damage to a vehicle. This is to the roof of a house. This is crops. This is supposed to be corn. This should all be about as high as a person, and it's been beaten down with hail. And weather modification does do a very good job of mitigating the effect of hailstorms. So it's actually used quite extensively worldwide to prevent hail. Now, a couple of countries like the United States, China, and India, and Russia, they all have particularly bad hailstorms, and this is used quite a bit to mitigate hail in those countries. But it's also used in most of Europe. France particularly uses it in order to protect the vineyards so that they have grapes for their wine. It's a very common and very effective practice because the cloud seeding causes the precipitation to fall before it can form into very large balls of hail. So you might still get hail, but it'll be a much smaller pellets and be a lot less damaging. Weather modification can also be used to reduce the effects of smog. This is a city in China, completely covered in smog, and China has completely embraced weather modification to stop smog. They have, in fact, they don't use the planes, they use rockets. This is an actual weather modification rocket launcher. And they've have reported success with this program. And they have recently, I think within the past 2 years, decided to set aside a very large area of Western China, an area the size of India, in fact, where they're going to do a massive amount of weather modification launches in order to help prevent smog in the more industrial Eastern China. They've also used it in order to help prevent smog and bad weather for the Beijing Olympics, and are expected to use it again for the upcoming Beijing Olympics when they host the Olympics one more time. There's actually one more use. So far, I've talked about governments using it in order to help try to prevent weather catastrophes, but weather modification is also very commonly used for ski resorts in order to make sure there's enough snow during ski season. And so this is private companies who are doing weather modification in order to just promote tourism. 11 states in the western United States have allowed and legalized private use of weather modification equipment, and it is extensively used by ski resorts. Now, the ski resorts tend to set their weather modification machines up on top of the mountain near the top of the ski lift. And those machines look like this. If you've ever gone skiing, you might actually see beyond the fences where you're not supposed to go, a machine that looks like this. And this machine is used to do weather modification and help create snow. And they don't need to use a plane and they don't need to use rockets because they're already on top of a mountain. So they're already up pretty high. And what they do is in that cylinder, they place silver iodine and they basically start a fire. And the smoke contains silver iodine and the smoke rises up into the clouds and seeds them. This has actually been pretty effective for ski resorts. And it's used not just in the United States, but it's also used in Canada. So that's been our talk on weather modification. Weather modification is a real thing. It's not some sort of government conspiracy. It's not even a secret. We've been doing it since 1946. It's very common worldwide. It's done not only by governments, but by private industry. By the way, weather modification done by private industry. In case you'd like to know about how much that costs, it costs roughly US$4,000. So it's not really that expensive when you're talking about a business doing it. So I hope you've enjoyed this talk about weather modification and weather control. If you did like it, please click the like button and please click subscribe. There should be a option for another video that you might want to watch. This has been Craig Explains Stuff. I'm Craig, and I'll see you next time.